Hey, what's up? That recovery yard walk was fun. I watched it several times, and I'll tell you, when I was there, the sun is so bright, I really couldn't see very good, but I could go back through the videos, and I think I spotted the ring I need to make a larger one of these chuck loading devices, so I can grind the jaws on that 12.5-inch bison chuck for this little axles in here. That was the chuck that came on it, and it must weigh 140 pounds. I want to weigh it. I'm really curious how heavy that is. But that was a lot of fun out there at that yard, and I don't know if I'm going to add to my problems, like drag anything more here. I just let it sit there for a while, and I've got so much to deal with here. And my storage, tool storage problems are working out pretty good. I've kind of rearranging stuff, and I'm starting at the back end, and I'm gonna get to the front end there where that bench is and just redo every single thing. Haul out everything I don't need and do better storage. And I have to use the walls. I only have room for this toolbox right there, and I like having that. But everything else is going to have to be on the walls. And this setup has worked really, really good. I've got it on the studs, but that's like a good, oh gosh, 250 pounds of tools right there. And the KDK stuff's a little bit awkward, and I think it's better on that little double shelf there. I've got around 25 holders. I don't know how many I got there, but that's working out great. I can see them, I can grab them. It might be better than having them in a toolbox, like behind me or something, because I just step over here and grab them. Got the Morse Taper 4 tools there. There's the porcupine of a tailstock turret. I got to shorten those tool holders to make that a little bit more efficient, and decide what holders. I need to use these narrower holders when using that, because I was having some collision problems. But you know, you kind of got to try stuff a little bit to get a better idea of how it needs to be. And I think for me, one of the best things I did is have it so I can center drill something and go right to a light center, and that's nice for the for lighter weight stuff, using this tailstock. So it's coming together, and I think that the tailstock turret will make this older machine a little bit more efficient, and that don't hurt. Hey, there's Chloe. What's up? Uh-huh. Pretty soon she's gonna be dragging me out of here for something. Okay, so I got to come up with a shelf or a rack to put on the wall for this 50 taper stuff. And I don't have very many 50 taper tools, but they're heavy, and I want to get whatever's in this toolbox out. Have more measuring instruments, and it's real easy to grab stuff off a shelf. So I'm on to that, and I'll turn on the camera when I got something else going here. Oh, back on this Monarch I have for sale here, I'm going to do a little bit of a tune-up on it and point out some stuff on the electrical. I'm trying to get around to it, but I can't do it with the sun shining pretty hot. I'll do it later tonight, but I'm going to have to adjust the price on it, because I sold the dynamically balanced custom four-jaw chuck and the tool post. So I'll lower the price according. Hey, I got my woodworking start building crates for stuff coming and going from the machine shop. And it kind of got into other kinds of woodworking with encouragement of my wife. Her dad was a Finnish carpenter, and she likes the smell of wood rather than the smell of oil and metal. So it's good for me to do woodworking. And wood can be quite strong, and you can work with wood that can be quite difficult too and get away with it as a machinist. And I'll show you a couple of things here. Now, my tool storage stuff in the garage, that rack that holds some Morse taper, is made out of maple. And this is a rifle case that I made out of maple. And I can't really show what's in it, because this is wonderful. Flowers and honey and rainbows. You too. You can't see that. You got it? Okay, so there's a rifle case. And it's really quite thin. And it's very, very strong. So I'm going to use this equipment. Here's a table saw, and it's really a mess. I'll be able to show how clean I get this in a couple hours. There's a planer back there, dust thing, and a bandsaw, 18-inch bandsaw, weighing a quarter. And this here is a jointer, an 8-inch grizzly jointer. I think it's the only, yeah, the jointer, that's a jet bandsaw, and that's a grizzly jointer. They both work good enough, but it's a Powermatic planer. And this device here is a Shota spindle molder. And it's like a shaper, except for it's got a overhead support like a horizontal milling machine. And it's even got an 1.25-inch arbor here. And I tell you what, I should demonstrate the American Rotary phase converter starting this up. I'll be right back. I'll go kick that on. Okay, I got the American Rotary kicked on. I had to go out to the shop, but eventually I'll have a start nut down here, a remote start for that. But rotary's working out great. Thought you might like to observe a high-speed machine here that's about 8,500 RPM. Really quite an amazing device. So let's fire it up. Let's look at it. And I want to remind people that what's set up here is considered extremely dangerous. But I have a way to do things here that's not really commonly known in the U.S. So let's start it up. Got a squirty starter there. Looking at about 8,500 RPMs pretty quickly. Really quite smooth. And not too loud, huh? Let's look down here. Okay, here's the spindle unit here. And it holds a quart of oil. And it circulates the oil through this tube to the top bearing. This, the bearings are grade 7 spherical bearings. And they were very hard to find, but I got them from Accurate Bearing, which is a good store. So, I actually am driving this thing with those link belts. And I've tried different belts, and this thing is just running glass smooth with those. So that's the spindle on the unit. Let's take a look at this construction of this thing. I hope you're interested. I think it's an interesting machine. I don't know if you can see how it's built. But it's got all this weight back here and this huge table with wings here. The motor's in here, about 5 horse. You can use up to 3 belts to drive the spindle. Now to change the speed on it, you change the pulley here, and it's got a built-in extractor. I think it'll go in DFD on this, but I don't know. It's not that big deal changing the pulley. Okay. I got a stud long travel indicator in there, you see, for height. You see, very handy. Now that overhead support moves with the spindle at all times, see? Making this a very unusual machine. And again, it's running at 8,500 RPMs, and that's 1.25-inch spindle shaft. Non-changeable on this. It's permanent. You can put a 7-inch stack of cutters in this machine. Totally amazing. Okay, I'm going to kick it off here. Okay, in order to safely use this machine, I'll have a board in front of here that I can push the blade through, and then I hold the work in this device here. This device is like a vise. It's like a wood vise, and I copied it from a design by a German guy named Egner that invented the more known Egner fence. And I think this is called a span lathe. And I've got another one that I built that's 36 inches long. So you can put the work in here and guide it across the cutters with your hands safely behind here, see? And you have to put a stop here to safely use that in case a cutter catches and it'll throw this thing. You gotta have a stop to catch it. Okay, I'm gonna demonstrate something here that can be demonstrated probably best right here. Okay. Now this is my Rockwell Delta 12-14-inch table saw. It weighs about 1,000 pounds. So I'm gonna crank that blade up, okay? And I think this thing's got 4 drive belts. We'll have a look at that. Now, belts take a set. Now I'm gonna show you that. See the blade spring back? Now, if you start this saw, it'll make that set worse because the motor all of a sudden torque and it'll make that bend in the belt worse. And then you'll have to run the machine longer for that set to get out. So what you do is you do this on your belt drive machine tools too. You roll it until it, see it's still gonna spring back. You roll it until it stops. Right there, see? Then it's best to let it sit for a while. But if you need to start the saw, like right now, let's start the saw. Kind of a nice soft start. This is 5 horsepower, 3-phase. Got a nice soft start with the that ADX 15 rotary phase converter from American Rotary. Nice running machine, real smooth. You could stand coins up on it. I don't know if I got anything laying around here. I don't know, here's the penny. All right, the wind will get it. I don't know if I can do it. There we go. There's the penny stirred up on this table saw. Isn't that nice? Okay, I'm gonna cut it off. Okay, that's a 12-inch blade. Let's see if it went back on that set. See, the set's gone. Isn't that nice? And it runs smooth. So, when you start something, it's best to roll your belt off that set. That's the tip of the day. And this thing just runs glass smooth. If I didn't do that, and the panty's still standing, if I didn't do that, it would vibrate for probably 15 minutes until the belts heated up and took that set out that way. And I think that's harder on your belts. Okay, now I got that tip from the Moore Special Tool Company. Alrighty. I will be back.